working, living, raising our kids there. We have a lot of family here, but we spent a number of years, probably 10 or 12, at Marysville Grace. And so we're happy to be here at Surly Marian Grace. Again, as Dale said, the scripture this morning is from the book of Titus. It's right after 2 Timothy. It's on page 168 of the worship Bibles in the chairs. But just a little context, this is a letter from Apostle Paul to Titus, who was really somebody he really nurtured and trained to be a leader of a church, actually the church in Crete. So from Titus, starting at verse 3. For we also once were foolish ourselves, disobedient, deceived, enslaved to various lusts and pleasures, spending our life in malice and envy, hateful, hating one another. But when the kindness of God our Savior and his love for mankind appeared, he saved us, not on the basis of deeds which we have done in righteousness, but according to his mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewing by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out upon us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that by being justified by his grace, we would be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This is a trustworthy statement, and concerning these things, I want you to speak confidently, so that those who have believed God will be careful to engage in good deeds. These things are good and profitable for men.
Thanks, Bob. All right. Just make sure you're still awake. Everybody is now, right? Either that or you're deaf now from that. All right. Nothing like getting an extra wake-up call. So Titus 3, we're going to be going there in a few moments in looking back at that again. So we're continuing the book of Acts. So if you want to turn, we'll be in Acts 18 and 19. If you can believe it, I'm going to cover two chapters in about 35 or 40 minutes. See, miracles never cease, right? So we've been in going through Acts, talking about the church on fire, what we can learn from the early church. And today we're looking at transformation. And so as we go back later to Titus 3, we'll see that progression of transformation in our salvation and what God does. But as we look at the early church, that's one of the things that we're going to see in these two chapters is some amazing transformation and how God works through his people in the lives of those who are lost and in the community. So thinking about transformation, this morning I was driving here, and if you know over there by the hospital, there's a little pond on the other side of the road from the hospital, and there's all these geese. Because, you know, the older geese had younger geese, had little geese, and they were really small, and now they've gotten to be pretty good size now. But this morning, so I'm driving here, and all these geese just walk out in the middle of the road, right in front of my truck. So I hit the brakes, and I'm like, hurry up, get across the road. And two of them just, it was like 5 minutes. There's a truck behind me, and we're sitting there, and it's just walking back and forth right in front of my truck. And I'm like, I could hit the gas and just run over the goose, but I didn't. I was really nice, and I waited patiently. It's like either geese or trains, right, when you're trying to get here. So I waited for the geese to walk on. Finally, I was honking at them. You know, they like to honk. They didn't honk back, but they finally crossed the road, got over. But as I was driving here, you know, I'm always looking for good sermon illustrations. But I was thinking, you know, as we think about transformation, if I had to just run over one of those geese, my truck would have transformed that goose's life, right? That goose would not have been the same after I ran over it, right? It would have looked very different. And so as we think about transformation, one of the things that especially we see it a lot in America, because, you know, even though we've moved away from Christianity a lot as a whole, as a nation, there's still a Christian influence here. There's mega churches and things. But one of the things that is my time in ministry and talking with a lot of people, and I struggle with this because even with a lot of different pastors and things that they say about what it means to be saved, to have salvation, to be born again. And here's the thing, if my truck could rearrange that goose's life, cannot the God that the universe cannot contain, can he not come in my life and change it? So, I mean, think about it. He spoke the universe into being. The scriptures tell us the universe cannot contain him. There's nowhere you can go and get away from him. And salvation, the mystery, the salvation, it says, is Christ in you. The mystery of the gospel is Christ in you, the hope of glory. So how can God enter someone's life and not change it? It's impossible. I mean, if a truck can rearrange a goose's life, and if I stood out on the interstate, an 18-wheeler would rearrange my life, right? I wouldn't be here if I was standing out on the interstate and got hit by a truck. So if God enters the life of a person, there has to be transformation. It has to be. It'll be different. It'll be slower and faster depending on circumstances. I mean, when someone is saved in a place of great persecution, they grow in faith and in the Lord very quickly because they're forced to. It's different here when we have so much in America, but transformation has to happen. And so the word that we're going to see in a few passages, transformed, the word is where we get our word metamorphosis. It means to be transformed, to transform the essential nature. So to be transformed, when the Bible speaks of that, the passage we're going to look at means our nature is changed. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old has passed. Behold, all things are new. So we are now a new being. That's what it means to be born again. You are a new creation, a new person, a new being. You're not the same. We're going to see that. But there in your notes, if you have your notes, it's just a definition of transformation. Transform the essential nature by the power of God through the power of the Holy Spirit. That's Acts 1:8. And the prayer, presence, and proclamation of God's people. As we've looked through Acts, that's what we've looked at. We started with the power of God and the Holy Spirit, the prayer of God's people, the presence of God's people, and the proclamation of God's people. That's what we've been looking at through the book of Acts. God has worked through the prayer, the presence, and the proclamation of his people to transform people's lives and even communities that we'll see here in a moment. So that's what we're looking at this morning. If you turn to Acts chapter 19, I just want to read a few verses. We'll be looking at both. I'm not going to read both chapters. That would take a while. So we'll just look at a few verses. Acts 19 and verse 11. God was performing extraordinary miracles by the hands of Paul, so that handkerchiefs or aprons were even carried from his body to the sick, and the diseases left them, and the evil spirits went out. But also some of the Jewish exorcists who went from place to place attempted to name over those who had the evil spirits the name of the Lord Jesus, saying, I adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preaches. Seven sons of one Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this, and the evil spirit answered and said to them, I recognize Jesus and I know about Paul, but who are you? And the man in whom was the evil spirit leaped on them and subdued all of them and overpowered them, so that they fled of the house naked and wounded. This became known to all, both Jews and Greeks, who lived in Ephesus, and fear fell upon them all, and the name of the Lord Jesus was being magnified. It's like, no kidding, right? In verse 18, many also of those who had believed kept coming, confessing and disclosing their practices, and many of those who practiced magic brought their books together and began burning them in the sight of everyone. everyone. And they counted up the price of them and found it 50,000 pieces of silver. So the word of the Lord was growing mightily and prevailing. So we see some examples of change there. And I want to point those out. But let's pray before we dive into God's word. God, we just come before you this morning. And God, we humble ourselves. Lord, no man can understand spiritual things without the work of your Spirit. And so we ask, Lord, give us ears that hear. Lord, give us hearts that are open to the work of your Holy Spirit this morning, that we might understand what it is that you are saying to each of us this morning. God, give us ears to hear your message and give us faith to respond, Lord, to who you are. And I pray, God, that we would be transformed by the power of your Spirit in this time today. In Jesus' name, amen. So examples, the first thing we're going to look at, and I just read a few there in Acts 19, is examples of heart of transformation. The first one is heart change. So if you have your notes, the first one, 1A, is heart change. And that's the Apostle Paul. Okay, sometimes we forget that. You know, we started there in 1911, and God was performing these miracles by Paul. But remember who Paul was. So turn back in your Bibles to Acts chapter 8, and let me just remind you who this Paul guy used to be. Acts 8, verse 1. So Paul, this is who he was before. Saul was in hearty agreement with putting him to death. That's Stephen. And on that day, a great persecution began against the church in Jerusalem, and they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Some devout men buried Stephen and made loud lamentation over him. But Saul began ravaging the church, entering house after house and dragging off men and women. He would put them in prison. And so Saul led the onslaught of persecution against the church. He hated Christ and he hated Christianity passionately. And he was killing, murdering Christians. When Stephen was stoned to death, he gave his approval. And he was stood there and was over that whole murder. And he murdered Christians and he pulled out women and children and men and he drug them to prison and he tried to get them to blaspheme the name of Christ. He hated Christ passionately. And he tried to wipe Christianity off the face of the earth. But that's who we're reading about in all through the book of Acts, who is now the biggest proponent of Christianity. Half the New Testament was written by the Apostle Paul, who was that murderer guy, Saul. But when he met Jesus on the road to Damascus, he was transformed. He was not the same being again. He was born again by the Spirit of God, and God put a new heart and a new mind within him that loved the things of God and was willing to lay down his life every single day as a Christian for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not just once or twice. Paul says every day his life was threatened for proclaiming Christ, the one he tried to wipe off the face of the earth. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? I mean, and when Paul came to Christ, the church didn't believe it. They didn't want to be around him because there's no way that God could save that guy. But do you see that here's somebody that's so violently against Christ, and yet when he met Christ, he was a different being. And he laid down his life for the glory of Christ. The other thing, another one we see there in Acts chapter 19, is in verse 11, we see the miracle of healing in Ephesus. And if you notice there at the end of verse 12, it says, diseases left them and evil spirits. So Paul is going, and again, when you think about healing, during this time, God gave certain men an ability to heal people. And that was to give, to show and give testimony and evidence that Christianity was the real deal. That Christ was the Messiah, that what was being spoken was true. There were signs and wonders that accompanied the apostles and other men during this time. We know now from James chapter 5, there's not men that have a gift of healing now. It's transferred to the elders of the church. That's what James 5 says. If you're sick, go to the elders of the church, and they will anoint you with oil, lay hands on you, and pray for you to be healed. And so when the church is getting going here, and as the church is established, we see in the book of James that God transfers, God still heals people. I believe that with all my heart. I mean, there's testimonies of that. I mean, you hear things from the charismatic bents, and sometimes we go, well, is that really true? But there's people that are very conservative that in very testimonies that, I mean, people that, you know, that would be a lot like us that give testimony of God healing people and doing miracles. God still does that. I mean, He just does. You know, I've seen some things in my own life that there's no way to explain it, but God worked. It was God. And so God still does that. And I want to make that clear. But you know, there's people on TV and stuff, oh, you know, buy this handkerchief because of this verse we just read, and God will heal you with that. Okay, that's a bunch of baloney. Don't give your money to that. That is not true. Those guys are fake. Okay, that's not, they're trying to take something and use that, and a lot of those guys are charlatans. But here, Paul, God is using him to heal people from sickness and demonic possession. And that's another thing that is, you know, that a lot of times we either don't want to talk about it, or we talk about it like there's a demon behind every doorknob, which is not right either. But there is demonic presence. There are demons. There is demon possession in the world. It happens. A believer cannot be possessed by a demon because you are possessed by the Spirit of Christ. And He's not letting any demons in. Okay? That doesn't happen. But here, so we see this. But one of the things is, as the gospel is being proclaimed, people are being healed. Some people are being raised from the dead. And also, demons are being cast out. I want to give you an example. Turn to Mark chapter 5. This is one of the most terrifying examples in the scriptures of demon possession and how Jesus heals this guy. Mark chapter 5, verse 1. They came to the other side of the sea in the country of the Gerasenes. Verse 2, when he got out of the boat, that's Jesus, immediately a man from the tombs with an unclean spirit met him. And he had his dwelling among the tombs. And no one was able to bind him anymore, even with a chain, because he had often been bound with shackles and chains, and the chains had been torn apart by him, and the shackles broken in pieces. And no one was strong enough to subdue him. Constantly, night and day, he was screaming among the tombs and in the mountains, and gashing himself with stones. Seeing Jesus from a distance, he ran up and bowed down before him, and shouting with a loud voice, he said, "What business do we have with each other, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I implore you by God, do not torment me." For he had been saying to him, "Come out of the man, you unclean spirit." And he was asking him, "What is your name?" And he said to him, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And he began to implore him earnestly not to send him out of the country. Now there was a large herd of swine feeding nearby on the mountain. The demons implored him, saying, "Send us into the swine so that we may enter them." Jesus gave them permission, and coming out, the unclean spirits entered the swine, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the sea, about 2,000 of them, and they were drowned in the sea. And it goes on, and the herdsmen get mad at Jesus. But here's a guy that is, and when you read in the other gospels, he was completely naked. and he can't be bound by chains and shackles because of the spirits, and legion was at least a couple thousand. We know that from the 2,000 swine, and a legion was not just like, you know, like a troop. It was a lot of soldiers. And so he had thousands of demons in him, this guy. And he could not be subdued. The guy, I mean, you imagine a guy living in the tombs. Nobody can subdue him for years. And what he would look like. And he comes running up to Jesus. And it's always interesting that the demons knew who Jesus was, but the Pharisees didn't. That's kind of interesting, isn't it? And so they're begging him for permission, showing Jesus has power over the demons and over healing and sickness and disease. Jesus displaying his power. And they ask for permission. But here's a guy that is, I mean, you can't subdue him with chain shackles. I mean, the guy had incredible strength, and he's just, I mean, his hair was probably long and matted, and he was filthy, he was naked, and he ran up to Jesus, and Jesus heals this guy, casts out the demons, and if you read the end of the story, he wants to, after he's released, and he's comes to faith in Christ, he wants to follow Jesus, and go with him, and he says, no, I want you go back to your town, and testify of me, and he goes everywhere, and proclaims Christ. A guy that was possessed by all these demons that, I mean, we would have put him in a mental hospital and closed the door in a padded cell is what we would have done with this guy. And yet Christ frees him, saves him, and he is completely transformed. And again, that's what we see in the book of Acts. We in the early church, as God was moving, people's lives were radically changed. The next thing is in verse 18 and 19 of chapter 19, we see changed lives in repentance. In verse 18, it says, many also of those who had believed kept coming, confessing, and disclosing their practices. Many of those who practiced magic brought their books together and began burning them in the sight of everyone. So here's a people that, as they're coming to faith in Christ, their lives are being transformed to the fact that they're coming and they're openly confessing their sins to the church, saying, this is who I was, this is what I was in, and this is what the issues that I have, and they're confessing their sins. With James says, if you confess your sins to one another, that you may be healed. They're doing exactly what God says, and so you see this happening, and notice there when it says they were burning these magic books, and it was 50,000 silver pieces. Do you know how much money that is? That's 137 years of wages. Think about in 137 years how much money you would make over that time. We're talking millions and millions of dollars. And they're throwing it in the fire. I mean, at great cost, they are getting rid of anything that was hindering them from Christ that they knew to be wrong because of now being born again. And they at great personal cost, they were doing, and why did they burn them? Because the Bible says you burn idols. You burn them, is what the Old Testament tells us. They would have known that, because as you look on down in chapter 19, people get really mad at the Apostle Paul because he is telling people, he's preaching against idolatry, and all these people are coming to faith in Christ. Look at verse 26. This is Demetrius, and he says, you see and hear that not only in Ephesus, but almost in all of Asia, this Paul has persuaded and turned away a considerable number of people, saying that gods made with hands are no gods at all. And so Paul's preaching against idolatry. The people are turning away from idolatry to the point that the people that make the idols are getting really mad, and they try to basically want to kill Paul, and they try to get him arrested and all this stuff, and you can read the rest of that story. But as Paul was preaching the gospel, he was preaching against idolatry, that this is wrong. And as people came to faith in Christ, they didn't just go, well, I'll keep my idols and ask Jesus to bless me. They got rid of their idols. because the gospel that was proclaimed was pointing out this is wrong. And they got rid of the idols, they turned away from it, and they, as they put their faith in Christ and followed him. And here's what's interesting. In William Booth, if you've heard of the Salvation Army, William and Catherine Booth that started that, when he preached, when he first started, he was an open-air preacher. I like the guy, he's an open-air preacher. I mean, he preached outside to crowds, wherever he could find them. And people, as he preached against sin, as people came to faith in Christ, they were drunks, they were alcoholics, and they turned away from it to where all the bars in the city shut down because there's nobody going to them. Not because William Booth said, you better not go there, or you're in trouble. Because when they came to faith in Christ, the Spirit of God within them changed their heart and their mind, and they didn't want that anymore. They wanted Christ, and they wanted to give their lives to Christ. And so you see this change of life, and you see this destruction of idols. That's the fourth one. And as they came to faith in Christ in Ephesus, they got rid of their idols. They destroyed them, and they followed Christ. And that was the power of God working in them in transformation. And those are examples. So as lives are changed by God's power, we know from 1 John 3:8 that Satan's works are destroyed. 1 John 3:8 says Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil, which it says is sin. Christ came to destroy sin, not just to have you come be part of a religious social group and you stay bound in sin. Christ came to set us free. And as Christ transforms us into a new creation, those chains of bondage and sin are broken. And we're free at salvation. There's times that we willingly walk in things. But if you are born again this morning, you are free from sin. I mean, if not, then the Bible's wrong, and we're all sitting here for nothing. Because Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil, and Jesus came, he said, if the Son has set you are free indeed. And he came to bring us liberty. And so when God's power and he puts his Spirit within us, he gives us a new heart and a new mind. The old man has died and we are free from sin. It's not that we don't struggle. It's not that, you know, we're still in this body that's not going to be redeemed. We're going to get a new body one day. But we're still tempted by the flesh. But we are free from sin. We are no longer bound and in chains and imprisoned by the things of the world. God has set us free. We are transformed. And that's what the Bible says in Ephesians 2. It says we used to be these terrible people, and it lists. And it says we were children of wrath by nature. But then it says in verse 4, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our sins, he made us alive in Christ. I mean, think about it. If you walked up on a dead guy, that he's dead, like for a few days, you can smell him. He's dead. And all of a sudden he gets up. Would you say, that's transformation? Yeah, right? That's what the Bible says about being born again. That we were dead. We stunk of the junk of the world and the death of man, the death of sin and all its mess. That we're dead in our sins. You walk up on roadkill, and it's not going anywhere unless you have to kick it, or it's just going to lay there. It's dead. And God says that we were dead in our sins, but he made us alive. That is transformation. If you're dead and now you're alive, that's not the same, right? The life of God is in you, and the life comes from the outside. If a raccoon is dead on the road, or I ran over one of those geese and it's dead, life's not coming from within, right? It's got to come from the outside. Salvation is of the Lord. And when we're dead in our sins, He made us alive in Christ. By grace, you have been saved. The Apostle Paul, he can't stand it. He can't even get to verse 8, where he talks about being saved by grace. He says it in 5. He just can't stand it. He's got to say we're saved by grace through faith. That's transformation. What were the results in society of transformation? This is number 2 in your notes. Look at verse 17. After the 7 sons of Sceva tried to cast out a demon, and they were not believers, they were just Jews, it says, you know, and the demon beat them all up. Verse 17 says, this became known to all, both Jews and Greeks who lived at Ephesus, and fear fell upon them all. The fear of God came over the community. See, when God begins to transform people's lives, and not just that we have some easy believism where we have a bunch of decisions and nobody's life has changed. When God begins to enter the lives of people and they are changed, and people begin to live differently, and the power of God's being displayed, the fear of God falls on society. You look through history. Every great revival in the history of the church started with the fear of God coming down on a community. When a preacher would preach the gospel, Whitfield, Wesley, those guys that God used, and they began to preach the truth, and the Spirit of God began to move, the fear of God fell upon the community. And they began to have the fear of the Lord and began to go, I need to be right with God. And that's what happens here. The fear of God falls on the community. Proverbs 1:7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Through the fear of the Lord, a man departs from evil. It's not a bad thing to fear God. I mean, He created everything. He's an awesome being. And when we come into it, I mean, what happens when somebody comes into the presence of the resurrected Christ? They pass out, right? I mean, even in the presence of angels, people were terrified. You imagine what it's like to be in the very presence of the Almighty? And so as God moved, fear comes upon the community because they see this is not of man. This is not a hoax. This is the power of God. And they see that in society. And what's the result of that? Jesus is magnified. The end of verse 17. The name of the Lord Jesus was being magnified. And that you know, the word magnified there means people were standing in awe of Jesus Christ. Notice, it wasn't a personality. It wasn't that Paul was such a charismatic guy. It wasn't some new strategy that the church came up with. As God worked, the name of Christ was magnified, and people stood in awe of Him. He was exalted, not men, not strategies, Jesus Christ. And then verse 20, what happens from there, as all this stuff is happening and people's lives are being changed, it says the word of the Lord was growing mightily and prevailing. The word prevail, the Greek word means strong, effective, ability to accomplish. So God's word became the dominant force in the community. In Ephesus, the dominant power was the word of God. As the Bible, as it was proclaimed, people's lives were changed. The word of God, as it continues to be proclaimed, people began to be changed. And it becomes the dominant force in Ephesus. That's what's happening here. And it says it prevails. It accomplished what it said it would accomplish. See, when you read the Bible, it's not just some religious book. When you and I begin to do what the book says will happen, will happen. When you begin to step out into faith and obey the Word of God, you will see what God's Word says. You'll see it happen. And it's powerful. That's why Jesus said, if you want to know that I'm from the Father, then do what I say and you'll see that these words are from the Father. Obey the Word of God. And so that's what's happening. God's Word is dominating Ephesus, and it's accomplishing the reason that God sent it out, and it's changing people's lives. But we also see in verse 23 through the rest of the chapter that there's a lot of enemies. When God begins to move, people get mad. You know, the guys making all the idols got mad because they were losing business. But I put the verse in there in 2D in your notes, what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 16:9. For a great and effective door has opened to me, and there are many what? Adversaries. When a door opens into to enemy territory, when God opens a door for ministry, for people to come to Christ, it's in enemy territory. And he doesn't roll over and just say, oh good, I'm glad you're here. He's going to attack. And Paul, every place that God opened a door, you read through Acts, every place, he was attacked by many adversaries because they wanted to shut his mouth so that he couldn't proclaim the gospel. And so let's look here with a couple passages to understand and apply transformation. How does this affect us today? In Acts 19:20, we read about the Word of God growing and prevailing. In Romans 1:16, it says, I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation. The word power there in the Greek is where we get our word dynamite. It's the power of the living God through the gospel. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 tells us that every word in the scripture is God-breathed. And it's useful for teaching, correcting, training, rebuking, and righteousness, that the man of God may be equipped for every good work. The vehicle of transformation that we see here in the book of Acts is the Word of God. As God's people proclaim the Word of God, that's the vehicle that the power of God flows through. The Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is working through the proclamation of God's Word and changing people's lives. That's the vehicle. It wasn't a strategy. It wasn't a method. It was a command that God gave His people. And when they did it, God moved in power. So the whole gospel and counsel of God is proclaimed by the church. We see that back in, and I'm just going to mention it briefly, back in Acts 19, verse 9 and 10, Paul, they're coming against Paul and blaspheming him, so he shakes off his clothes and his shoes, and he goes to this school of Tyrannus, and all his disciples come to the school, and every day for however long, it's like a year or two, he preaches and teaches the Word of God. Well, if in verse 10 it says, all of Asia heard the gospel. So Paul begins to teach the church, the new disciples, the Word of God, and they immediately take it out to the point in 2 years all of Asia had heard the gospel. See, the power of God was working, the vehicle was through God's people proclaiming the Word of God and the truth. So as we think about that today, you and I, as God's people, we are the vehicle that the gospel will go through to a lost world. There's no plan B here, folks. It's us. The church is the hope of the world. If we don't do it, nobody else is going to do it. God has called us to take light to the darkness. And then our passage that Bob read in Titus, if you'll turn there to Titus 3, I want to show you the progression of transformation. So look at verse 3, for we also, and every time you see one of these, like in Philippians or Ephesians 2, you see the same thing. Notice what it says in verse 3, for we also once were. We're not continued to be, are we? We once were foolish, disobedient, deceived, enslaved. We once were enslaved, which means we're not now. To various lusts and pleasures, spending our life in malice, that's hatred, envy, hateful, hating one another. But when the kindness of God our Savior and His love for mankind appeared, He saved us. So notice the progression. How did they know that they were enslaved to various lusts? They were hateful and disobedient, foolish. How'd they know that? Because when the gospel was proclaimed, they preached against sin. They called out people's sin and said, this is wrong. That's void from many pulpits in America today, because I don't want to offend anybody. But we got to understand that we have a sin problem before we understand we have a need for Christ, for a Savior. So they understand there are these things because it was pointed out. And as the Spirit of God helped them understand, they realized their sin. It was revealed. And then they noticed that judgment is realized, that there's a judgment day because of my sin. There's consequences to that. And then notice what it says in verse 4. But when the kindness of God our Savior and His love for mankind appeared. See, they realize their sin. They realize the consequence that the wrath of God abided on them. But then they saw the love of God in Christ. And as they understood the kindness and love of God through Jesus, it changed their life. Notice verse 5. He saved us, not on the basis of deeds which we have done. They realized they were so full of sin, there was no way they could be good enough to get to God. They needed His love in Christ. That's what it says. Not by deeds we've done in righteousness, but according to His mercy, by the washing of regeneration, renewing of the Holy Spirit, whom He poured out upon us richly through Jesus Christ our who? Savior. Why did they call Him Savior? Because they knew they needed to be saved from something. Does that make sense? You don't want a Savior if you're not drowning, right? You got to know that you're drowning and going to die before you say, "Help, I need help," right? So why is Jesus called Savior? Because our sin brings death and it brings the wrath of God in hell forever. We need a Savior. And God loved us and showed His kindness that He gave us one. And so they see this, they understand God's love and kindness in Christ results in a changed life. We once were these things. But notice that it continues on, resulting in praise and love to God and hope of eternity. Notice what it says in verse 7. So being justified by His grace, we would be heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This is a trustworthy statement. Then it goes on and look what it says. What will happen to those who believe God? What will they engage in? Good deeds. The result of salvation is love and praise to God, and we go and do something, not to get God's mercy. Notice they already had it. They saw they already had the love and mercy of God, but because of being loved and being transformed, it motivated them to go and do something in love for other people. Does that make sense? You see how that works? It's not to gain God's favor. It's not so God won't be mad at me. I'm going to do all this stuff. It's because I have the love and mercy and kindness of God that I never deserved, that I should have had wrath, and yet He gave me mercy in Christ. And because of the love of God given to me, I love people. That's what it, and it says that God has poured out His love in our hearts. If we're believers, man, one of the evidences of being a true believer is you love people. And not just people that love you, people that don't love you. We love people because Christ loved us. And the last passage I want to look at is in Romans 12, where it really explains transformation. So that's the progression of transformation. And then I want to show you applying the transformation in our lives. Romans 12, verse 1 says, therefore. When you see the word therefore, what do? What is it there for? You go back. So look at verse 33 of Romans 11. Chapters 1 through 11 of Romans is just a gospel tract. That's all it is. It's the gospel. Paul comes to the end of the gospel, and look how he responds. Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are His judgments and unfathomable His ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord? Who became His counselor? Who has first given to Him that it might be paid back to Him again? For from Him and through Him and to Him are all things. To Him be the glory forever. Amen. Paul preaches to the Romans the gospel. Romans is one of the deepest books in Scripture. It's deep. And all it is the gospel. But Paul comes to the end of the gospel, and all he can do is praise God and say how deep, what are the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. And so when we're thinking about 12:1, remember, we got to go back to the first 11 chapters is what the therefore is pointing to, which is the gospel. And Paul says he comes to he can't even describe the depth of the riches of God. And I want you to think about this morning. Have you ever been to the ocean? You imagine, get yourself out a little rowboat. Row out there like 20 miles where you can't see the shore and look around. When Ruth and I, one time we were in Atlanta and we were at the aquarium, and there's a sign when you walked in that said, we've only discovered 5% of the oceans. That means there's 95% that man has not even, we have never been to. I mean, the ocean is miles and miles and miles deep. There's mountains in the bottom of the ocean, right? I mean, there's places we can't even go to with all of our technology. We can't get down there because of the water pressure. Now imagine yourself out in this boat and you're looking and you're just trying to bring in the vastness of the ocean. That is the gospel. The gospel is the ocean. The creatures of the ocean are the doctrines and the truths of Scripture. But Paul comes to the end of the gospel and he cannot describe its greatness and its vastness because of who God is. The gospel is not one of these basic things we learn when we're first a Christian, then we move on to other things. It encompasses everything. And so imagine being there and looking out across the ocean and realizing, I'm really small. This is really big. When Paul came to the end of the gospel, the Apostle Paul, that's what he came to. This is really big and I'm really small. The gospel, all of the universe is about God and His glory. And I want to look what he says. We even sang this. Who has known the mind of the Lord? Who became His counselor? But look where he ends in verse 36. From Him, through Him, to Him are all things. To Him be the glory. Salvation is not about you. The gospel is not about you. The Bible's not about you or me. It is about the living God who created the universe. Psalm 24:1, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. He is the awesome creator of all things. And everything in the universe is made by Him and for His glory. That's what it says. That's what God testifies in His Word, that He has made all of us for His glory. We benefit from God loving us. But it's not about me. It's not about you. It's about Him. And we are blessed and we have benefits and we have God's love. But it's because of who He is. The gospel is not about, you know, God being your rabbit's foot or God being, it's all about, you know, just solving your problems. The gospel is about God glorifying Himself through Jesus Christ being crushed on the cross and rising from the dead. So the universe will see the greatness of the grace and mercy and love of God in the cross and be drawn to God and His mercy because of Christ. That's what Paul says. This is about God. Therefore, now look at therefore. I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice. Because of the vast greatness, majesty of God. Because that God owes us nothing. This is not popular in America. But I want to remind you, the God of the universe owes me nothing. I have committed crimes against Him. He gave me life, and I sinned against Him and committed crimes, and so has all of humanity. God owes us nothing. God, what we all deserve, the Bible says, is God's judgment and wrath. And there's, think about it, there's no way to be good enough. There's no way for us to enter into heaven on our own. If God doesn't do something, we are all lost and doomed for eternity. And yet this God, who created all things, who is perfect, righteous, justice, holy, pure, never sinned, He is light, there is no darkness, not one wrong thought ever. He's always done what is true, right, and good, and perfect. That God came to this foul place called earth, humbled Himself to become a low-class person on earth, went to a low-class criminal death on a cross, and died to pay for your crimes. That's the mercy of God. Do you see? There's nothing we can do because we are dead in our sins. Remember? We're dead. Life has got to come from the outside or we're doomed. And so God comes after us. He doesn't leave us in that state because His church is His bride. And He comes after His bride to rescue us because He passionately loves us. He comes after us and He gives Himself on a cross. I mean, this low-class criminal death, even to mankind. And the perfect God of the universe humbled Himself to the cross. And He died to pay for your crimes when you could never do anything to earn it. That is the mercy of God. That is the love and the grace of the Almighty for you alone. Because He loves you. And He has shown you His mercy. And Paul says, because of the mercy of God, give Him your life. Take your body and offer it up on an altar and sacrifice your life to God. That is what transformation is about. It's not about trying to not make God be mad at me. It's not about riding the fence. It's not about what I can do to try to earn His favor. I have the mercy of God, and because of the mercy of God, it's about me giving my life to Him. And people walk in depression and discouragement and they never come out of it. And there's we have all these issues because we're always trying to get something from God. I need more of Him. I need this. God, give me this. And God's saying, give me your life and I will do with you what you could never dream. That's what transformation. Notice what it goes on in verse 2. This, and he says, you giving your life is worship. And then in verse 2 it says, don't be conformed, but be transformed. Be changed. How do we be transformed? Not by trying to keep a list of do's and don'ts. How do we earn God's favor? It's not by doing anything. It's by realizing the mercy of God and saying, oh God, here's my life. You want to have joy and peace? You want your life to mean something? Quit riding the fence. It's not about what can I get away with and God not be mad at me. I mean, that is so, the American church is just full of that. Well, I'm going to, you know, what can I do? And so God's not mad. I'm trying to get as close to the fire as I can without being burned. And God's saying, give me your life. I want it all. Give me your heart. I want to take you and use you for my glory on this earth now. But I want to again just say, this transformation is not about God doing something more for you. It's about you giving yourself to Him. Not out of legalism, not because I have to, but by the mercy of God that He's shown you. You see the difference? I mean, that's why you have all these religions and legalism in the church and all this stuff. It's, you know, well, I have to do this and I can't do that and I got to do this and all these crazy things. And God's saying, look at what I've done. Look at my mercy and love, and then give me your life, and I will take your life and transform it and use you for my glory. Amen? Be transformed, church. And right now, we're going to sing, I know that we're going a little long. It's 12:15. But I have a song that I want us, as we play this song, what needs to happen right now. And I had this last night as I was up here praying. We need a Garden of Gethsemane moment. You need a Garden of Gethsemane where Jesus said to the Father, Father, I'm scared to death. I know what's coming, your wrath. Not my will, but thine be done. Here is my life. And this morning, as we respond to the mercy of God, as this song plays, and you look at the words, and just stay seated, but I want you to consider the love of God that came after you and give Him your life. Lay it down. All your desires, all your needs, everything that you want, everything that you struggle with, everything from your past, the things that have hurt you, and all of it. Just take it and say, Lord, here I am. And give Him your life once and for all. Offer your life on the altar to God. And He says, that is worship. It's giving our lives to God. It's not just singing songs. It's worship in giving our lives to Him. And that's what needs to happen right now in our lives. So let's play. Will you guys go ahead and play that song? And just as it plays, just let the truth sink in and just respond. Pray, respond to God, however you need to do that.
Oh, you glad love moved first? Even when there's no hope, He loved us. His life because of the mercy of God,
the love of God. Do you see the difference between that and legalism and trying to earn something from God or try to do enough so God's not mad at you? You see the difference in that? Don't ride the fence. Give God your life and He'll make you like Jesus and use you to do things that you can never do on your own and for impact eternity. Don't we serve an amazing God? Know that He loves you, that He has given you mercy, and just respond to His mercy and worship Him. Let's pray. God, thank You for our time together today. God, thank You for the grace of Your people to let us go longer and just be, Lord, in tune with what it is that You wanted to say this morning. God, I just pray for each of us that God will have that Garden of Gethsemane moment. We'll just take everything that we are, everything that we have and struggle with, and the good, the bad, the ugly, and Lord, we'll just offer up our life to You because of Your mercy. And God, may it be worship that's pleasing to You. And God, may we be transformed by the renewing of our minds and the truth of Your Word and the Gospel. God, bless and encourage Your people today. In Jesus' name, amen. You're dismissed.